Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon. It is 3:03 in the afternoon. It's Wednesday, January 17th. This is our first meeting of 2024. We have had a wonderful annual retreat today, and we're going to continue that tradition of excellence this evening. Before we begin with the invocation, let me go ahead and call the meeting to order. Is there a motion to allow Commissioner Porter to participate telephonically?
So moved, Mr. Mayor.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion. Second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Passes unanimously 4-0. Do we have Commissioner Porter online? Commissioner Porter?
Yes, Mr. Mayor.
Hear us?
I heard her.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Okay, we got you. Great. Thank you. It is my honor and privilege to introduce Dr. Michael Fagans, the Associate Minister at Bethel Missionary Baptist Church, who will be providing the invocation to kick us off right. Ladies and gentlemen, will you please stand for the invocation? Dr. Fagans, great to see you, sir.
Thank you. Likewise, Mayor. Everyone, let us pray. Eternal God, as we come before you in prayer, we thank you for your goodness that you have shown to us as a city. As we assemble now, we invite your spirit to guide and direct us so that we may work together to make our community a better place. Be with us now and use our coming together for your glory and for your kingdom. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, if you will join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. All right, ladies and gentlemen, once again, let me welcome you to the city chambers. We've got a great meeting ahead of us today. We do not have a scheduled public hearing at 6 o'clock, so we will just go until we are done. We do have room for unagended speakers at the end and look forward to hearing from everyone. As I like to begin all meetings, let us all try to strive to do the best we can to set the example, not only here in chambers and throughout Tallahassee, but throughout the nation and throughout the world, on how to conduct business respectfully and listening to each other, even if we might disagree. But let's please pull together and set the example. This is the bicentennial year. This is a wonderful time to be in Tallahassee, and I know that we can do it together. With that, let me turn it over to the city manager, who will tell us about an agenda modification. But before so, let me be the first to state on behalf of the City Commission, Amy Tomans, congratulations on unanimously being offered the position. City Attorney. We enjoy working with you, and we look forward to the years. With that, Mr. Manager, do we have any agenda modifications?
Yes, sir. As appropriate, item 12.03 has been added to your material. It is the approval of city attorney employment agreement. It will be the last policy item.
Excellent. Sounds great. Any questions about the agenda modifications? All right. Sounds wonderful. Colleagues, you are more than welcome to join me if you'd like for two presentations. Well. And as my colleagues are joining me, I would like to ask Dr. Robin Haslin Thompson, the Executive Director of the Survive and Thrive Advocacy Center, Tabitha Reynolds with International Rescue Committee, and all of our friends to please come join us. Come on, Devin, come join us as well. Susan Turner. About right here, Robin, that'd be great. Ladies and gentlemen, from the governing body of the City of Tallahassee, a proclamation. Whereas human trafficking is a $150 billion a year global criminal enterprise and a human rights violation, and Florida is ranked third in the nation by the National Human Trafficking Hotline. And whereas here in Tallahassee, sex and labor traffickers ruthlessly target and exploit children and youth, persons of color, the LGBTQ plus population, homeless and displaced individuals, persons with disabilities, immigrants, college students, those with financial hardships, and many others for greed and profit. And whereas the public and private sector can play a vital role in preventing sex and labor trafficking and supportive care for trafficking survivors by educating employees, including law enforcement, inspectors, emergency responders, security and utility workers, and by supporting community nonprofits, businesses, and members of the public who gather for community programs and events with information about human trafficking. And whereas the Survive and Thrive Advocacy Center with the International Rescue Committee and many community partners work every day to empower survivors of human trafficking to heal and rebuild their lives and educate the community with the City of Tallahassee-funded StackPro, a training program where hundreds of Tallahassee businesses have been educated on how to spot and respond to trafficking in the workplace. Now, therefore, I, John Evans Daly, by the authority vested in me as the mayor of the City of Tallahassee, do hereby recognize January as National Human Trafficking Prevention Month. Read into the record in front of each and every one of you here today, signed with my signature, dated January 17th, 2024. Dr. Hassel-Thompson, let me present this to you on behalf of the City of Tallahassee and invite you to provide some comments.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you,
please.
Good afternoon, everyone. As the mayor said, this is National Human Trafficking Prevention Month, and we are honored here today by this tremendously. I'd also like to acknowledge and thank our board members who are here and our STAC staff, Renee Sterrett, Susan Turner, who's our president of the STAC board, Debbie Kearney, STAC board member, as you mentioned, Tabitha Reynolds, who's with the International Rescue Committee, Kimberly Lyles, who's also part of the IRC and does their housing program. And just from what you said in the proclamation, there are just two points I'd like to really mention and thank you for. One is every January we have the opportunity to share with people that, yes, both sex and labor trafficking are tragic realities right here in the City of Tallahassee and right here in the Big Bend of Florida. Too often, we see movies that only depict trafficking happening in other countries, or only in large cities, or only sex trafficking when they think of human trafficking. But you should know that our agencies have served and assisted hundreds of human trafficking survivors, with almost half of those being survivors of labor trafficking. And also to know that anyone can be a victim of trafficking. It could be a child or an adult. It could be someone who's elderly. It could be any race, any gender, anyone. It's really traffickers, as the proclamation says, targets people who have unmet needs and who have vulnerabilities. So that said, that's why this month is so great to have the opportunity to talk about this issue. I'd like to thank you all, and Mr. Mayor, you mentioned how the city has funded StackPro, which is an educational program that has literally helped establish a free online, this is a commercial, online training for everyone to understand what human trafficking is and how to spot it in your own orbits, whether it's your workplace, whether it is if you're in a hospital, a neighborhood, wherever you are, you can understand more about what human trafficking is, how to recognize it, and how to help people who are vulnerable. With that, too, know that this month is chock-a-block with lots of activities, so you can come and enjoy fellowship and connection with community partners, because that is how we do this work. The IRC is one of the many partners that STAC works with every week. We're at the Kearney Center and at the Hope Community. Every day we're tabling at events and doing all kinds of outreach. So if there's ever the truth of the phrase, it takes a village, I promise you that phrase, it takes a village, is really the only way we're able to address human trafficking in our community and help end it. That said, I know that we have your support. All of the county, City Commission has been here 1,000,000%. All of you are great. So with that, I'd like to thank you. Also to invite you on January 30th at 621 Gallery here in Tallahassee. There'll be a we call it our gratitude event. It is the time we look to those in the community who have been stepping up on this issue. It will be at 621 Gallery. We'll be unveiling some art, and we're going to be taking art to the whole community that STACK assists, which is in all the rural areas, every place in our town, if you will, or our city, as well as all the way to Liberty County and over to Jefferson. We're going to be taking a huge mural to forge community conversations with everyone in the community about what trafficking looks like in their community, how they can do something about it, and how we're all connected in addressing this issue. So that's January 30th at 621. Hope to see you there. Information on our website, surviveandthriveadvocacy.org. So with that, Tabitha?
Oh, hello. Hi, my name's Tabitha Reynolds. I'm the IRC's anti-trafficking program coordinator. We have two grants, one of which we partner with STACK on, and we also have all of our interns and new staff take STACK Pro. It's an easy way to get them in immediately. I just want to thank everybody for the new initiatives that have been coming out and all of the work that we're doing. We have both a direct services grant and a housing grant, which my lovely lady here runs. And we're just so humbled to be in this area. IRC has been in Miami servicing survivors for 20 years, and this is some of the newer within the last few years that IRC has come to the Big Bend. So I'm really glad to be on this team and working in this area and doing all that we can. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you. May we get a picture?
Yeah.
Come on, Tabitha.
Let's go.
Hey, Susan. Susan.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to ask Reginald Ofwani and all of the incredible men and women of the city of Tallahassee who continuously, day in and day out, make our city beautiful and protect our tree canopy. Come on up. Come on up. Thanks for coming in, y'all.
Oh, man.
This is a dream team right here.
Yes, it is.
Great to see everybody. All right, ladies and gentlemen, from the governing body of the city of Tallahassee, a proclamation. Whereas in 1872, J. Sterling Morton proposed to the Nebraska Board of Agriculture that a special day be set aside for the planting of trees. And whereas Arbor Day is now observed throughout the nation and the world, and whereas trees can cut energy use for heating and cooling, help clean the air, reduce stormwater runoff, produce life-giving oxygen, and provide habitat for wildlife, and whereas Tallahassee has one of the highest percentages of tree canopy coverage in the nation at 55% and has for 31 consecutive years been recognized by the Arbor Day Foundation as a Tree City USA community. And whereas a healthy urban forest has repeatedly been shown to be a critical component to a vibrant and livable community, economically, environmentally, and socially, and whereas the city of Tallahassee adopted its Urban Forest Master Plan in 2018 as a guide for the future of our community's tree canopy and to approve this vital city asset as our community changes in the coming years. And let me pause right there. These are the men and women right here that take care of that tree canopy right in Tallahassee. And whereas the city of Tallahassee employs more than 20 certified arborists and tree care professionals who provide close care for trees within our public right-of-ways, participate in reforestation efforts, help educate residents about proper care for trees on private property. And whereas hundreds of trees are planted by the city of Tallahassee on residential property each year, free of charge through its popular Adopt a Tree program. And whereas trees have always been an essential part of our community's excellent quality of life, adding joy and spiritual comfort to generations of residents and visitors alike. And whereas, now therefore, I, John Evans Daly, by the authority vested in me as the mayor of the city of Tallahassee, do hereby proclaim Saturday, June 20th, 2024, as Arbor Day in the city of Tallahassee. And we urge all citizens to plant and care for trees to help continue the long-lasting relationship between trees and our community. I further encourage Tallahassee residents to support efforts to protect our existing trees so that we may all enjoy the many benefits of majestic, mature trees in the future. Read into the record in front of each and every one of you, signed with my signature, dated today, January 17th, 2024. On behalf of all of the men and women, a hearty thank you for everything that you do to help keep our city beautiful. Reginald Afwani, let me present this proclamation to you and invite you for a couple of comments.
Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon, Mayor, Commissioners, elected officials. It's really a great pleasure. Whenever we talk about trees and stuff like that, it's kind of amazing. Tallahassee is full of trees, but there are many men and women that make this happen. And beside me, these are just a few of the many of them that are here. I would like to get Marianne to kind of speak a little bit about it because I want to give her credit. She's in charge of that area.
Yeah.
The chief, and that is Chris Revel, is the chief for that particular area. But Marianne handles a lot of the trees, and I'd like for her to say something about it. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. I'm Marianne Teasley. I'm the urban forestry supervisor. We take care of everything from within the city right-of-way, trimming. We handle all of the dangerous trees, and we also help with the storm cleanup and everything. So I wanted to say thank you to everyone for your understanding during the past year's storms and everything. Also, thank you. The Adopt-A-Tree program is ongoing and is a phenomenal program where everyone is eligible to receive up to 2 trees on their private property. So if you haven't put in your application, go ahead and do that. As Mr. Afwani said, these are just a few of our certified arborists and tree professionals that are within the city of Tallahassee. So they do the majority of the work, and they are out there to help everyone. So let's give them a round of applause for all the work that they do.
When's Arbor Day? Oh, I was about to say, man.
Okay. I was like,
great job. Thank you.
Okay, we are now on any announcements before. I have 2 bicentennial announcements. Do you have anything to bring to the table right now?
No, sir.
Okay. This is our first meeting in the bicentennial year. It's 2024. I have 2 very important and exciting announcements to make as we continuously update both the commission and the public on some of the many things that are going on in our community. You know, we have many stories to tell, great stories to tell about our history. Some of them are painful, some of them we celebrate. One of the stories that we have to tell about our community is how we became the capital of the state of Florida, but before that, the capital of the territory of La Florida. At our centennial celebration 100 years ago, this community came together and built an artistic interpretation of the first Florida Capitol building. It was that one-room log cabin building that was located here. We know the story of the gentleman that met from Pensacola and from St. Augustine halfway to declare that this would be the territorial site for the government. At the 150-year celebration just 50 years ago, our community did the same thing. We have a rich tradition of reenacting by building the first Florida one-room Capitol building, and this year will be no different. So the Bicentennial Committee, which is many, many, many individuals, and Tallahassee Historical Society, which continues to uplift this community, and many fine individuals that are dedicated to this particular project have come together, and that we are about to embark on a community build of the first Florida Capitol. We've got two PSAs to show real quick. One is a minute long and one is 45 seconds long. If we could show those PSAs.
Tallahassee has come a long way since 1824, and our future is bright.
In our bicentennial year, we have a wonderful opportunity to bring Florida's first capital back to life.
Florida's first capital holds a special place in our hearts. The replica launched our centennial in 1924.
The first capital is a chance to tell the full story of Tallahassee's founding from the eyes of all its people.
Our democracy was born in a cabin on a hill. That democracy has been our guiding light towards a more perfect union.
The first Florida capital, part of a full year of bicentennial celebration in the capital city.
Coming to Cascades Park in the summer of 2024.
The weary party arrived at length by way of a gentle rise upon the summit of a commanding eminence. Here they made halt and soon discovered the marks designating the site of the seat of government of Florida. Party was not long in selecting their campground. To the eastward, their view was more confined, which screened the view, but not the sound of the beautiful cascade. The party commenced building a house. After 2 days, hands arrived and put up three buildings to accommodate the legislative council.
In our first days, our democracy was born in a cabin on a hill. That democracy has been our guiding light towards a more perfect union.
The first capital is a chance to tell the full story of Tallahassee's founding from the eyes of all its people.
Florida's first capital holds a special place in our hearts. The replica launched our centennial in 1924.
In our bicentennial year, we have a wonderful opportunity to bring Florida's first capital back to life. Mr. Banger, those PSAs were made and donated by volunteers here in the community. I think they did a great job. Let me take a second to real quickly recognize Cassidy. Stand up so we can give you a shout out. You did a great job. Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. I also want to take a second to recognize, for the videos in particular, C.B. Lorch, Chris Scheip, and Frank Terraferma, and Bob Knight, who kind of volunteered to put it all together. I thought it turned out real well.
Yeah,
absolutely. Thanks for inviting me to participate. For the actual effort itself, a lot of the details are still being worked out, and there's going to be a grand announcement coming up pretty soon. I can tell you, though, that we are very pleased to have talented individuals, retired Colonel Tim Tankersley, who's helping us out as well, Mr. Bob Knight, who's helping us out as well. I'm extremely pleased that some of the leaders of this project will be Ms. Altamise Barnes herself, Senator Bill Montford himself. We've got some heavy hitters that are involved.
Yes.
The Secretary of State's office is involved. Florida Legislature will be involved as well, along with the local volunteers in our community. So more to come. We just wanted to send out the teaser. It is going to be located in Cascades Park. I want to thank Ashley Edwards and your team for all the amazing work that you have done to help us locate it. This is a temporary display that will take place during 2024. It will not be permanent, but it's going to be really exciting. And thanks again for coming out today, too. On a separate note, I want to announce that Mrs. Daly and I will be hosting the Bicentennial Ball. This is not necessarily a City of Tallahassee event. No taxpayer dollars will be spent, but this will be a fundraiser for the Tempo Foundation here locally. And it will be put on locally as well. That will be Saturday, March 2nd at the FSU Student Union on campus. Tallahassee Nights Live will be performing. We will have local restaurants providing food. It's going to be a great time. More to come on that as well. Those are the only two bicentennial announcements that I have right now. I'm sure there will be more throughout the year. Another announcement? Yes, ma'am.
Well, I think, Mr. Mayor, with all of this bicentennial announcement and information you're sharing, does that make you the bicentennial mayor?
It does. How about that?
Okay. So knighted. You're the bicentennial mayor.
Sounds great. I appreciate it. Okay, we do have one appearance from another appointed board, committee, or other governmental entities. We're on 7.01, which is the acceptance of the Tallahassee-Leon County Commission on the Status of Women and Girls Annual Report. Courtney Thomas, Director of External Affairs from my office, will kick it off. Courtney, thank you, and please introduce everyone who is here with you.
Good afternoon, Mayor Commissioners. Item 7.01 is the acceptance of the Tallahassee-Leon County Commission on the Status of Women and Girls Annual Report, and with us today we have Executive Director Stephanie Shumate, as well as the Chair, current Chair, Adela Gademi, and more board members with them as well. So I'll let them introduce board members.
Wonderful. Please come join us.
Thank y'all so much. I'm really excited about these bicentennial events too. But thank you so much, Courtney, for your assistance and being our liaison and mayor and commissioners. And exciting shout out, Amy, just a fun. We really appreciate Amy as being our city attorney liaison previously, and now we're really excited for you. So thank you for all your help over the years, and we appreciate it. But yes, as Courtney said, we're here to present our last year's annual report for the commission. As y'all know, we entered into a very exciting kind of glow up, reimagined version of the commission on the status of women and girls with our 2.0 plan last year. And so I have with me today our amazing chair of this current year, Adela Gademi, and I'm gonna let her introduce herself. But before that, I do want to take a second to recognize our wonderful other commissioners and staff that joined us. We have our vice chair, Dr. Jasmine Simmons Bryant, and we have commissioners Dr. O'Conn, Commissioner Kay Meyer, Commissioner Carla McClellan, and our staff, Amanda Hernandez, our program assistant, and then Kelly Audi from the Oasis Center for Women and Girls, our fiduciary agent. So thank you all for being here and showing our support. But I'm going to turn it over to Adela, and then we'll get more into.
And Mr. Mayor, while she's coming to the mic, I am proud to say that I am the commission's liaison to the commission on the status
of women
and girls. We never miss
Commissioner Richardson at any of our events, so we really
Yes, thank you. And hi, it's wonderful to be here with you all today. I'm Adela Gademi. It's my fourth year on the commission, and previously to now getting the pleasure of serving as the chair, I had chaired three committees for each of the previous 3 years that I was on the commission. My day job is that I'm the director of organizing for United Faculty of Florida, so working for higher education, labor, and preserving academic freedom in our state. I'm a few weeks away from finishing my doctorate as well, so ready to have that done and excited for the year.
We'll have to get our new name tag.
So. Yes, I'll turn it back over.
Last year, this is just an overview of our leadership from last year, and we were here with Dr. Cicely Brantley presenting the report and her theme for the previous year. So the biggest thing that I think from last year as we entered in is really making sure that no woman or girl was left behind with the intersections of all of the issues that women and girls in our community face. So we are really incredibly thankful to our leadership team for last year and charging that first year of the 2.0. We have I can give these out, but some of our annual reports that kind of go through very briefly all of the 13 deliverables and where we are that was in that 2.0 plan and kind of the status and where we're headed for this coming year. So you'll see that some of those familiar faces are here in the audience today. But highlights from those, we expanded the staffing. Here I am. I just finished my 1 year in the end of October, and it's been a whirlwind of a year, and I have
loved every single minute of it and feel very honored to be serving in this role and getting to work alongside 21 amazing women in our community to improve the lives of women and girls. So we also expanded staffing with our program assistant, part-time program assistant, and we really expanded our intern program. And we have a new intern starting tomorrow, which actually, huge thanks to Mayor Daley and Courtney Thomas for connecting us. I don't know where she went, but to Carly Gordon. She met with y'all, and y'all gave her a list of amazing things to check out. She reached out to us. She reached out to Stack and is also...
Carly's going to be interning with y'all.
She is intern, and she is a ball of energy, and we can't wait to get started. Tomorrow is her first day, and I know she's already partnered with Robin at Stack and has written some blog posts and is doing some really exciting things. So thank you for that connection, and we're excited about that. So we developed our action plan to guide the next couple of years for the 2.0. And we know with any good strategic or action plan, y'all just had your retreat this morning. It's a living, breathing document, and it's always revisited and looked at. And for future years, we know that there will be a new strategic plan of guiding the next 5 or so years. So we're excited to be in that year too. And it was, we worked with a consultant over the summer to go ahead and do that. And the other big undertaking was looking at those previous 142 recommendations that came before the city and the county and actually refining them, prioritizing, and looking at the language to truly come back to y'all, which I'll let Commissioner and Chair Gadimi go into. With true policy language and where we're headed down the road with some of those previous recommendations. We expanded the membership of our committees to over 45 community committee members, which some of them are here as well, which we appreciate all of our community committee members. We have a slew of wonderful experts in their fields sitting on our six dimensions, and we truly could not do the work without them. And I think the expansion in that 2.0 plan was one of the best things that could have happened, bringing more community input. We coordinated multiple community connection meetings and town halls, about 10 to be exact, in that first year. And we started the research on the digital dashboard, measuring the well-being of women and girls, which Chair Gadimi will go into a little more detail. Last summer, we launched a published community calendar of events on our website of specific events pertaining to women and girls. You can also submit your own events. Those are updated daily. So if you ever have an event, we'll be putting the ball on there and when we have the unveiling. So anything pertaining to women and girls. So it's a great place, another resource to our community. I'm going to turn it back over to Adela to really talk more about the theme for this year and where we're at and where we're headed.
Thank you. So to build off of the theme that Chair Brantley had started last year, I came up with a theme that I really wanted to take and hone in even more on some of what she had started and really be able to elevate it this year. So wanted to make sure that our theme was embracing gender equity for an inclusive tomorrow here in our community. And when we had our retreat and I was explaining, you know, the visualization of what I meant, I kind of was mentioning, I want to make sure with everything that we're doing, we're thinking about the lifespan of women and girls from diapers to diapers, right? We want to make sure that we're not leaving behind or over-focusing in any one area. And regardless of how wonderful all of our intentions can be, if we're not actively pushing back against biases that conscious or unconscious exist, then we're not going to be able to come back to you and bring you quality proposals for policy recommendations, which is what we want to do. So we're trying to put into place some systems within our committees and within what we're the way we work to make sure that we'll be able to do that. And when we come back, be able to give you some very inclusive policies that have thought through some of the things that maybe you know could pop up. That we want to try and anticipate anything that could pop up as we move forward. So here you'll see these are our lovely committee chairs for this year. And as Stephanie had mentioned, each one of these areas is one of our six dimensions for the lives of women and girls. So we have education, economic security, employment and earnings, health and development, political equity, and violence and safety. And so our committee chairs are rock stars, and with the work of their community committee members, we're definitely getting to have even deeper, more enriching conversations, diving in and having additional help to do the research we need to do, to have the important discussions we need to do, to again be able to come back and really have some meaty proposals to bring to you. So Yeah, just to think about a little bit of what we're doing from here. We're very excited about being able to move forward with launching the digital dashboard. The goal with that tool is going to be that once it's created, it's a tool that over time will be able to help provide even more insight to make direct policy recommendations for areas where we know that there is improvement needed to be able to serve women and girls in our community. So we're very excited to see about how we're going to have that launch. We do have a team of researchers from FSU, primarily some from the ASCII School of Public Administration and Policy, but we did want to diversify disciplines. So we have some from urban and regional planning. We have them from social work and sociology as well, so that we can make sure that they can collaborate with our data science firm to make sure that we're thinking through every possible way when we create this digital dashboard that we can ensure we take the data that we already have in existence and be able to synthesize it in a way that will provide the route to make these recommendations. And if we know that there's an area where we want the data, we don't have it, then we can also recommend that we would like to begin thinking about how we can gather that data long term so that we can make those recommendations. And so we are very excited. The RFP is out now for the data science firm, and we're hoping that that will be something that we can lock in the next few weeks, and hoping that by summer, ideally, we'll be able to come back and really have something moving on that for you. And so just to give you a little preview of some of the other things that we're working on, these are some of the main policy recommendation areas that are currently in process right now within our committees. So we will be coming back shortly with some fleshed out proposals relating to maternity policies, childcare access and affordability, bystander intervention trainings, STAC Pro trainings. We have several areas within the LGBTQ plus community support that we have some initiatives we would want to work through with you all. Addressing the mental health of women and girls and chronic absenteeism in schools, as well as menstruation, hygiene, supply, accessibility within the community. So we're really excited about all of the things that we can come back and talk to you about. But I'm going to turn it over to Stephanie to talk a little bit about our big summit.
I would appreciate a drum roll, no, but one of the things that was in our 2.0 plan was to host biennially Women and Girls Empowerment Summit, or a summit of some kind, and we are excited. Next slide. Our summit, save the date. It is April 15th. I've been joking, but do your taxes in advance and come and party with us instead of on tax day. So it will be held at FSU Turnbull Center, and the theme this year is advocacy, resilience, and empowerment. Are you ready? We are ready. A-R-E. I don't know. Anyone? Okay, thanks to Amy. Amy gave me a smile. So we are really jazzed about this summit, and the goal is to educate. It's a multiple-prong approach with this summit, and it hasn't been done in a couple of years. We've had girl summits in the past. We've had empowerment summits. We're really looking at having this be a summit where decision makers, policy gurus, advocates, providers, but also women and girls in our community that are looking to get more resources, get more information, are all able to come together. So we are having an exciting keynote. Lisa Hinkleman from Ruling Our Experiences will be coming, and she does some amazing data. I'll send you the recent ROCS report, and she collects nationwide about what our girls are experiencing in current status, especially coming out of COVID. Some of the data is really staggering. So we're really excited to have her come and present to us. We'll have those three tracks, the advocacy track, resilience, empowerment, along with the Women Can Run program, which is a program for women interested in running for office or also being involved on campaigns. So essentially four tracks. We'll have over 20 breakout sessions. We're anticipating about 300 attendees, and sponsorship opportunities are available currently, and the presenter applications and registrations will open towards the end of this month. So please save it on your calendars. We would love to have you there and involved in the summit in any capacity. So if you can't tell, we're really excited about it. So I'll turn it back over to Adela to talk through a little more.
What time will it be?
Good question. We are modeling it. We're starting in the lunchtime, so we'll kick it off with a lunchtime keynote, and we'll actually go into the evening about 7. So people that are working will have the opportunity to be able to come after those working hours, and we did that intentionally. So it'll be from 11:30 to 7, and we're really jazzed about it. So we hope to see you there.
Awesome.
Yes, and as if this was not enough, yeah. There is more. So some of the other things that are going to be continuing moving forward, you know, we are going to continue coordinating continuum connection meetings with various women and girls serving organizations. That's something that we really find valuable and important for us to be continuing to do. And we've had some examples from the fall that we can share of things that did work. We did partner with Prevention of Pathways for their conference. We were there for that. We did have a December winter conversation. And we are going to continue to have those quarterly events. And those have been already, even just with one, very invaluable, because given the fact that we're developing these policy recommendations within our committee area work, it's a great opportunity to have members of the community almost hear what the plan is and give us direct feedback right away, or identify an area for us within what we're talking about that they would want us to focus on or think about differently. So it's been incredibly valuable for us. And so we're looking forward to continuing to have more. We're having one in February, one in April, and one in August as well.
April's this summer.
Yes. So combo there. And then, of course, as we mentioned, we want to make sure we're launching by the summer our digital resource library. And then again, we're going to continue to have some additional ongoing work. We're going to continue to make sure we're hosting listening sessions and providing opportunities for input from our community members. Want to make sure that we're hearing and making space so that folks can find the CSWG approachable and know that we're here trying to work to better the lives of women and girls, and we want to hear from others because we don't think this happens in a silo at all. And so we want to make sure that we can have as many people be a part of the process as possible. We also obviously want to be making sure all of our commissioners are scheduling regular meetings with all of you and our county commissioners as well, and being able to speak with you all directly one-on-one. And we do have our regular standing monthly meetings that are going to continue that we have, which, again, everyone is always welcome to attend if you would like. And then we're going to continue to research more and about issues facing women and girls. If something is timely that comes up, we will create an ad hoc committee to address it, which we have already done some this year. And we're going to make sure that we're, you know, doing everything we can to increase awareness, not only around the issues, but also any campaigns that are happening to educate people about what's really happening. Anything we can do to help raise the profile and raise awareness, we're going to make sure that we're focusing on continuously. So that is a little bit of that, and we will, if you have any questions for us, we'll take them.
Thank y'all so much for having
us. Thank you.
And, I'll hand these to y'all's aides, but this goes through a little bit more in depth what was accomplished last year in a summary form that you just received.
Excellent. Mr. Clerk, do we have any public comment on this item?
No, sir.
Okay. Great presentation. All of your policy items are absolutely phenomenal. Two in particular I want to point out. I'm actually one of about three or four mayors in the state of Florida that actually has an LGBTQ plus advisory council. You have an open invitation anytime. You come present and begin the dialogue. Would love to see the policy recommendations that come out of your policy committee that then can be brought eventually for consideration. Number two, I am personally interested in participating in your conversation about child care accessibility and affordability. It was touched on earlier today by Commissioner Porter that I have been interested in this subject for years, and I have had several conversations in the community. There is a growing interest of thinking outside the box, 24-hour type facility, 7 days a week. I want to be part of that conversation with the commission and bring the resources and the conversations that I've had to the table as well. So please let me know when y'all are meeting to discuss. I mean, all of them are great. Want to be involved, but if I have to pick two, I want to leave you with those two.
We'll absolutely follow up with you and loop you in. Thank you.
That would be great.
Yeah, Commissioner Pryor, who's one of our newer commissioners, she's very adamant and passionate about the child care. And as a new mom and also our vice chair, we like to say not only do we have 21 commissioners, we have two baby female commissioners, but that were born last year. So those issues are, you know, I think near and dear to, closer to home, essentially, to some of our commissioners now. So yes, we welcome that conversation and partnership for sure.
Cool, and congratulations on your PhD. That's incredible.
Thank you.
Any other comments or questions, motions to accept the report? Commissioner Williams-Cox.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And I, too, appreciate such a robust and great report. I've had the opportunity to work with you on planning your Women Can Run event. And unfortunately, we were not able to fully implement it. So I look forward to being able to work with you again on that. I have some stories
really?
That I could share. So thank you again for continuing to try to get more of us to run for office. Our voices are needed in very important places where decisions are being made. So with that, Mr. Mayor, I would move acceptance of the report from the Commission on the Status of Women and Girls.
Motion's been properly made by Commissioner Williams-Cox, seconded by the Mayor Pro Tem. Mayor Pro Tem, you are recognized for comment.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. You know, as a girl dad myself, that I'm very proud of my two, and a wonderful wife, women's issues have been so important to me all of my life. I was primarily raised by my mother. There was eight of us. My dad was in the military and traveled a lot. And so women have played an important role in my life, all of my life. My first experience in state government, I was given that opportunity by then Education Commissioner Betty Castor. And so it has been my commitment to work with women on issues that impact them in any way that I can. And so it's been my honor and certainly my pleasure to be the liaison to the Commission on the Status of Women and Girls. For the commission, I try to make as many meetings as I can and events so that I can bring back to the commission, Mayor, those issues that are important to women in our community. And so I look forward to continuing that journey with you all.
Thank you
as
so
we
much.
Go forward.
And thank you for being our liaison to the
thank
commission.
You.
Mr. Matlow.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you for the presentation. You know, we deal with so much at the city. It's so great to have a dedicated outside body focusing and refocusing us on issues that really matter in the community. So I look forward to any specific recommendations you guys bring forward and then how we can work together in the future. Thank you.
Yeah, and you got a rock star group of women that are serving.
Yeah.
I mean, the firepower that you have is very impressive, and I know amazing things are to come. Thank you all so much. All those in favor of the motion on the table signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed. Passes unanimously 5-0 with Commissioner Porter by telephone. Thank you very much. We are on the consent agenda. Mr. Manager, has anything been pulled off consent?
No, sir.
Move consent, Mr. Mayor.
Second.
There is a motion and second. Is there any public comment on consent?
Yes, Mayor. We have speakers on items 8.01 and 8.02.
We're going to pull 8.01 and 8.02. and come back to those in a second. So the motion on the table is for item 8.03, 8.04, 8.05. Any questions? See none. All those in favor of the motion on the table signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Passes unanimously with Commissioner Porter by phone for 8.03, 04, 05. Mr. Manager, we are back now on 8.01.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This item seeks your approval for funding, additional funding, for $878,000. It is for the International Processing Facility, otherwise referred to as the Customs Facility at the Tallahassee International Airport. It would authorize me or my designee to execute any necessary changes to the contract, which is with White Cell Green Incorporated. David Pollard and his staff are here if you have any questions on this.
Okay, it was not pulled by a commissioner, but we have public comment. Let's go forward.
Thank you, Mayor. We have one speaker on the item, Stanley Sims.
Thank you for joining us. Your name and address for the record, please.
Can I get some media?
Get the camera turned on?
Can you turn it on? It ain't going to take long, and it ain't going to hurt. My name is Stanley Sims. I'm at 1320 Avondale Way. And, Mr. Mayor, I could not let this moment pass for the work that Mr. David Pullock did. We had the opportunity to do a workshop, but he introduced to every entrepreneur, small, medium, and large, of how to access the airport. I'm a hard guy to impress, but this presentation, Mayor, was very impressive. It was so impressive that I called Mr. Keith Byers, and I told Keith that Mr. David Pullock has set the mold. I also called County Commissioner Bill Proctor, and Bill asked me, was David my cousin? I said, yes, you know. But what my point here today is, they have done such an eloquent job of explaining to us local minority businesses of how to access their procurement system. And the way they do it is not a norm. It's like he sits down. He talks to you. He don't want you to, it's not a one-way exchange of information. It's a two-way exchange. And that conversation leads to other possibilities that you may not even know that was possible, that you could partner with the airport. And the reason I really want to bring this up, I had to leave earlier today at the retreat, and that was missed. Because that's what makes our community thrive. That's what rises those people from the bottom. That makes us think we have a chance. I've lived in Tallahassee all of my life. I never thought that I could do work at the airport. Mr. Pullock David said, even though you may have some challenges or may have made some mistakes, no, you may not be flying a plane, but there is something out there that we can help, that you can get connect. And it wasn't talk, Mayor. It was deliverance. They brought examples. T.C. Bakery, someone that I know, went to school with, I know their cousins, their mamas. If they could do it, they made the dream a reality in my face. Hats off to you, Mr. David, and all of your staff out there at the airport.
Excellent. Any other further comment?
No, sir, not on this item.
Great. Hats off to the airport as well for adding JetBlue service. We have not had a meeting since we've been able to celebrate. That's phenomenal, too.
Staff recommendation.
Here. Been properly moved. Staff recommendation by the Mayor Pro Tem, seconded by Commissioner Williams-Cox. Seeing no further comment. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed.
Aye.
Passes unanimously 5-0 with Commissioner Porter by phone. We're on 8.02. Mr. Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This one seeks your approval to accept a grant for the recreational trails and Tom Brown Park. It's an amount of $320,000. This involves our mountain bike trail near the animal shelter. Ashley Edwards is here if we have any questions on this matter.
Excellent. Was not pulled by Commissioner. We have public comment on this item.
Yes, sir, Mayor. Our first speaker is Andrew Peterson. We have one additional speaker. I neglected to say before Mr. Sims' comments, each speaker will have 3 minutes for remarks with a white in front of the mayor signifying green when your time begins, and then yellow as you hit the 30-second mark, and then ultimately red.
Great. Thanks for joining us. Name and address for the record, please.
Yes, sir. Andrew Peterson and 1900 Center Point Boulevard. Good afternoon, Mayor and Commissioners. My name is Andrew Peterson. I'm a father of three. I'm a software applications engineer for the Agency for Healthcare Administration. An avid free ride mountain biker, a 2023 Timba board member, host of the Timba Pump Track Race Series, and coach for youth mountain biking. For the past 2 years, a crew of mountain bikers and I have spent over 1,000 community service hours keeping up the Tom Brown Park jump facilities. And we've run into, you know, a lot of challenges. One being having sustainable trails due to the trails being made of dirt, and also having safe trails that we can keep constantly at a performance level that is safe for all levels of riders. This grant that we have asked for approval will help provide safe and sustainable features that are very much needed not only in our city but the surrounding panhandle area, as we don't have very many mountain bike access to quality mountain bike trails. And in addition, these funds will assist the city and the county's goals of obtaining the IMBA designation to become a mountain biking destination city. So today I ask that you help us in keeping our momentum in growing the mountain biking community along with the other outdoor activities of our city. Thank you.
Thank you. And you know what? I've always wondered, and it's great to be able to put a face and a name with all those volunteer hours, the thousands of hours from the community that keep the trails up and work with Parks and Rec. Really appreciate it, man. Really do. Thank you. Our next speaker.
Next speaker is Doug Bell.
Mr. Bell, your name and address for the record, please.
Yes, sir. My name is Doug Bell, 216 Hawk Meadow Drive. Good afternoon. I am the president of the Tallahassee Mountain Bike Association, and Andrew and I are unfamiliar with the commission procedure, so I think we at least temporarily have inadvertently pulled this item off the consent agenda, but we're all for it. I'm also here with Mark Anderson, who is a former board member of the Tallahassee Mountain Bike Association as well, and we wanted to publicly thank your staff for putting together this grant application and for all the work that they do on the trails. You all should, I think, commend your staff for the terrific work they do on the trails. Tallahassee has fantastic trails with the county, the city, the state park, the national forest, and the water management district. A lot of different land managers, but all of those trails together make Tallahassee a pretty darn good destination, and we've got elevation. So we've got hills that a lot of places in Florida don't have. And as Andrew mentioned, one of the things that we are pursuing with Visit Tallahassee and with your help as well is getting a particular designation from the International Mountain Bike Association showing that we really are top-notch, and that will bring a lot of cyclists to Tallahassee to ride. Those of us that live here travel outside the state to visit these places with our families, so it's a good economic engine. So thank you very much. Thank your staff. We support this item.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you, Doug.
Any other public comment?
No, sir.
All right. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Probably moved. Staff recommendation has been probably moved by the Mayor Pro Tem, seconded by Commissioner Williams-Cox. Commissioner Matlow, you're recognized.
Oh, I just want to say you never have to apologize for telling us we're doing something good. We appreciate positive feedback as well. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, thank you. Before we take the vote, and while you guys are here, I don't know if there's any appetite. I know before COVID, there was strong momentum of bringing a mountain biking festival to Tallahassee, similar but on a smaller scale to start off with in Fat Tire. I'm all in. And if there is appetite to begin that conversation again, I would love to be at the table and help out. I think it would be amazing, and I think that we could have a pretty cool festival if the appetite is there within the community. Just saying. Okay.
So you're riding a mountain bike?
I do. I don't ride as much as I used to, but I do love to get out. The trails are incredible. That's why I was, quite honestly, saying earlier how much I appreciate the volunteer hours. There are people behind the scenes that we never know that just volunteer their time to go clean out the trails and complement our Parks and Recreation Department. You know, you think about these big storms that come through. It's not necessarily Parks and Recreation employees out cleaning the trails of fallen trees and stuff. Nah, it's volunteers. It's great, great, great families here in Tallahassee that do that. But I do. I like to get out and ride a little bit.
I'm just impressed. I just learned something new about you, Mayor.
That's right. That's right. And I got street cred. I've been over the handlebars on the jumps over at Brown Park. Yeah, you know what I'm talking about, too. Yeah. All right. All those in favor of the motion on the table, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Aye.
Passes unanimously with Commissioner Porter by phone. All right. We are off the consent agenda. We are on 11.01, the introduction of ordinance. Madam Attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Item number 11.01 is the introduction of ordinance number 24-0-03, an ordinance of the City of Tallahassee, Florida, amending section 1-2 of the Land Development Code concerning the definition of the term accessory dwelling unit, providing for conflicts, providing for severability, and providing for an effective date. The recommended action is option one, introduce ordinance number 24-0-03, and set the first and only public hearing for February 21st, 2024 at 6 p.m. in the City of Tallahassee City Commission Chambers at City Hall.
Okay, do we have any public comment on this item?
We do have one speaker on this item, Mayor, okay. Jake Kiker.
Before we get to Mr. Kiker, I'm going to ask Mr. Reddick to come up and put this in non-legal speak for us non-attorneys and what we're dealing with here for the public.
Sure. Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. This item before you, it is a fix within our land development code that we've identified from engaging with our staff, engaging day after day with people coming in looking at pursuing accessory dwelling units or mother-in-law suites or whatever you want to call them, and running into this challenge. And We did, as a city, update our standards for accessory dwelling units in 2017. This one requirement, which is that ADUs, as they're commonly called, are they have to share their utilities with the main house, and they have to share the same address. And now, as we recognize ADUs as an opportunity to improve housing diversity and other opportunities for supplemental income, or, you know, and what they can provide to property owners, that was a big inhibitor that we kept running into. So where the improvements we did in 2017 really increased the amount of people coming, inquiring about doing this, this was a big hurdle that kept sending people back and not wanting to do this. So what this would do is a one-sentence change to our code that would allow for these ADUs to have unique utility connections, have a unique address, and a unique utility account.
Excellent. Mr. Kiker? Your name and address for the record, please.
Yes, my name is Jake Kiker. I live at 222 Oakland Avenue, Tallahassee, Florida, 32301. First off, thank you, Mr. Reddick. I had a chance to meet with him a couple of weeks back, and the growth management staff has been really phenomenal in terms of their time and energy, and not just this ordinance, but specifically for the project that I'm speaking on. And so what I have kind of two asks. One, this fix is definitely needed. This is one we specifically discussed. The fix that I'm talking about, though, is actually another portion of the ADU provisions, which actually are dealing with size limitations. And so the example that I'll give, so my wife and I, we did a ground-up construction on two townhome units on the corner of 6th and Adams, right across the street from Mr. Matlow's pizza spot, kind of a modern-looking two-unit buildings there. We met with growth management staff in planning to do an ADU. We wanted to do a one-bedroom, one-bath unit on each of them. So in essence, you have two single-family homes. We're going to do a one-bedroom, one-bath on each one of those separate lots. However, when we went in, my assumption, again, remembering what was going on in 2017, was, okay, as long as we're under 800 square feet, we're going to be fine. In actuality, there's also a provision in the ADU code that limits the square footage to no more than 40% of the primary residence. Well, when we did the original development, we tried to keep it in keeping with the neighborhood scheme. We only built them at 1,400 square feet. They're relatively small. They're two bedrooms, two baths. We didn't want to build McMansions downtown. We wanted to do something that kind of fit with the urban fabric. Well, by doing that, that means that the ADUs we like to build can be no more than 560 square feet. And for comparison purposes, the median square footage for a one-bedroom unit nationwide in 2023 is 757 square feet. And so what I'm asking is for, while we're doing this fix, let's go ahead and add another fix and simply do a basic size limitation. There's already one existing in here for no more than 800 square feet when dealing with a single family structure, which would be fine here. The reason being is that I think it provides for more consistency and more importantly gives us, again, the ability to provide some affordable housing and other options in these areas. I don't think it's a huge, you know, again, a huge stretch to do that. And so the other, I think that's, again, that's a fix that we can do at the same time, which will be very, very helpful. And the outcome, for instance, if we don't do this, we will actually be having to go through a multifamily development permitting process to add a single 650 square foot, one bedroom, one bath unit, which means concurrency. It means design reviews. It means a whole lot of steps that, frankly, adding a 650 square foot, one bedroom house in the middle of downtown shouldn't have to go through. And it's probably one of the reasons why we see very little incremental infill development in these areas. The second fix is what I think we can do to actually promote more of this, like, community-wide. And again, Mr. Reddick and I had the chance to talk just, you know, both in the actual but also abstract in terms of what other communities are doing. And one thing that we're seeing, and again, this has all evolved since 2017, is pre-approved plans. And the example I will give is Raleigh, North Carolina, Modesto, California. Several municipalities actually have pre-approved ADU plans ranging from 450 square feet to 1,000 square feet. You get a fast-track permit, the local bodies,
seconds.
Yeah, I've already reviewed them. We have the FAMU School of Architecture, which I think has some talented folks that could work with local architecture and design firms to put the same type of housing inventory on the books for our ADU process to actually encourage them to stay in our community, work with local incremental builders to do these things. I think it's a great opportunity.
Thank you, Mr. Kiker. Appreciate it. Okay. John, I know that you and Mr. Kiker said that y'all been working together. Talk to me about... Look, I know that this commission fully supports ADUs. We have taken that position before. So the question is, how do we make it easier for people that want to do the right thing to be able to do the right thing? So what Mr. Kiker was just talking about, what's your position?
I would say similar to this, what we brought before you today is it's based on a lot of feedback. The changes that we see is feedback from people who are actually trying to do it and not being able to implement. we had historically, we as a city have had ADUs based on a proportionate size allowance based on the size of your house. It's well into the early 90s, not prior to that. I think it's something that in the last 4 to 5 years has really taken a lot of progressive steps nationwide to look at better ways to implement them, use them as a tool, make them more effective as a tool. And with that, you are seeing fewer municipalities actually going by a proportionate size and saying, let's have an equal entitlement to homeowners, basically. Say, what Mr. Kiger's alluding to, is saying it, don't penalize for having a smaller house, and instead say everyone's a lot of the same equal size.
So what I'm hearing, Mr. Manager, is we don't necessarily have a problem with the suggestion that Mr. Kiger's made.
Mr. Mayor, may I add?
Sure,
I don't know that staff has a problem with it. I would say all of these conditions have come about based on relationships with our neighborhoods.
Correct.
So, you know, I would evaluate that first. I'm not sure we have that answer. Maybe John can give that. But from a staff point of view, you know, we totally understand.
Okay.
And at 40%, so that may make something unfeasible if you have a relatively small house. We would be very comfortable with it. But it may be worth testing that with our neighborhoods if you would like. If you were inclined to make that change, that could happen quickly. But I'd just say those things, that's how those limits came about.
Madam Attorney, I'm assuming that, I mean, if there were any amendments to be made tonight, which I'm not suggesting, they would have to be made tonight because at the next public hearing, it's up or down.
That's
on
correct.
What's being proposed.
That is correct.
Okay.
And any amendments that would be, you know, the way that works is if it's very significant, then we would have to renotice it, reintroduce it.
Right.
So it kind of depends on how significant the amendments would be.
Mr. Manager, is there a rush to get this done tonight? Begin the process right now.
I'll ask John.
No, Mayor, it be at your discretion.
So, colleagues, one thing to consider is, very rarely do I actually suggest this, postponing action. See if we can get the answer to this question with our neighborhoods. The answer might be, no, we don't like the recommendation, therefore this comes back in the exact form and we move forward. I would hate to get in a situation where this goes to the next final public hearing for an up or down vote and we decide that, no, actually we want to pull it and start this process all over and include the recommendations. I mean, I don't know. Or do we go forward with this and then maybe do another one to include the new language if neighborhoods sign off on it. What are your thoughts, Commissioner Williams-Cox and then Commissioner Matlow?
I prefer to do it all at once.
Okay.
So it's comprehensive, so we don't, you know, miss anything and not have to keep coming back.
Excellent. Commissioner Matlow.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I don't have strong feelings on the order. I think this is a good step forward and wouldn't want to delay it too long. I anticipate
right.
We will get pushback if we decide to change the limits, but if our goal is to increase the amount of ADUs that are coming before growth management and actually getting approved, we've seen what's in place now isn't really encouraging that. There's people all over that want them, and whether it's the size limitations or the utility limitations, there's all these reasons why they're not doing it. So what's on the books now doesn't necessarily encourage the development of ADUs. I'm in support of it already, just recognizing the need for it, particularly in our urban core, people with enough land on their personal property, and just the affordability issue for homeowners. So I think the arguments in support of encouraging ADUs are worth it, but I do think it will be probably a tough community conversation to have.
I agree.
Yeah, just Mayor very Pinto. Quickly, Mr. Mayor, in light of the dire need for affordable housing in our community, I would be in favor of doing whatever we need to do to increase that availability. And if it means having to postpone this for however long to address this issue, I would be good with it.
Okay, sounds good. Commissioner Porter, do you have any comment on this item?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I'll just say I support the recommendations. I also don't have a strong opinion on the order. Although I support them, I think it's wise to postpone making changes today so that the public does have a chance to engage with the proposed changes. But I do support them, and I think we all agree that This is an important step forward and something we've discussed at different times. And I think Mr. Kiker for bringing it up and staff for working with him on this.
Excellent. Okay, Mr. Manager for comment.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think we've got good direction. We can move fast on this, and that may be even a better change. I think the direction, and certainly what staff is moving toward, is how do we encourage ADUs? We've had them available, but they've really not taken off. So we see a great opportunity. I think these changes could be great. I would like to, and I don't know the answer, clarified. Mr. Kiker asked about maybe an expedited permitting standard, if you had some standard building plans. I believe, and John, if this may be the answer, that would be a building permit, which would fall within our 2.5-3 days time frame.
Yes.
Already. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. So that 2.51 day metric you saw earlier today. That would
fall. I think we're approving them, even if they're custom. You know, I think we're approving them pretty fast. I'm not sure we would achieve a lot of efficiency by limiting that. I think we're probably in good order there.
Excellent. Okay. So, Madam Attorney, what is the proper posture? I mean, technically, it's read into the record, and we don't have to take action, but yet now we don't want to introduce it into the record. We want to go back to the drawing board and bring it back. Option so what is two. Your recommendation?
Option two?
Yes, which is...
Which is nothing.
No, option two says do not initiate and introduce and provide staff with alternate
right.
direction.
Where are you saying option? Where are you saying option?
It's at the bottom of that agenda item.
Got to scroll up. Oh, there we go. I was looking at the options at the top. Yeah, okay. So is there a motion for option two?
So moved.
Second.
Excellent. All right. Properly moved by Commissioner Williams-Cox, seconded by the Mayor Pro Tem. Any further comment? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Passes 5-0 with Commissioner Porter by telephone. We look forward to revisiting this. Thanks for working with Mr. Kiker on this. And by the way, Mr. Reddick, while we have you at the retreat today, it was brought up. The numbers for permits for residential commercial are outstanding. Average 2.5 days for review. Great job to you and the team. Keep up the good work. Thank you. Okay, we are on policy formation and direction, 12.01. Mr. Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Let me ask David Pollard to come forward to present this item. I think it feels a little bit like the Chinese New Year. This seems like the year of the airport. We have started off well with JetBlue, and I think we've got a great item. I think it's indicative of what is happening, the enthusiasm. You know, I mentioned before, we've all been out there. We've seen the progress. You see the progress with the road network, with progress with the airport. And so I think it is very infectious, and we have another item, a good item to share and seek your approval. I'll ask David to share the details.
Mr. Pollard.
Thank you, Manager, Mayor, Commissioners, appointed officials. Certainly appreciate the support and the guidance that we receive from this commission, the great support and teamwork with our city manager, assistant city manager, and the entire city team. We obviously can't do it by ourselves. We continue to stay focused. You know, I show these at every time I come up here. We continue to stay focused on the strategic priorities outlined in the city strategic plan, and we're making great progress on that while also listening to earlier discussion today, starting to set the stage for the next round of strategic priorities as we move ahead. Wawa is a branded convenience store. You're certainly familiar. I think most people in here are familiar. What we're bringing forward is the result of discussions, many months of discussions with Wawa. And, you know, we know they're coming into this community. We certainly wanted to be a part of that as well, have some ideal parcels available. We call it Parcel C, which is right at the corner of Spring Hill Road and Capitol Circle. Which is ideal for this location, given the improvements associated with the state's road project on Capitol Circle Southwest there, as well as the way it comes together with the airport gateway project as well. So obviously multi-pump gas station, electric vehicle charging points, fresh foods, built-to-order sandwiches, other food and beverage products. Like I said, I think most of us are familiar with the Wawa brand and concept here. What we've negotiated up to this point is they're leasing 3.3 acres at that intersection, making a minimum capital investment of $7 million, as well as providing the airport with a new revenue stream, which is very important as we just announced the JetBlue service. This helps us significantly as we work to lower our rates and charges and become more competitive for new air service opportunities. We throw this in the bucket of non-aeronautical revenue. So this really, really, really helps us as we continue to move ahead. So it provides $5.7 million in new revenue to the airport. It also creates 39 permanent jobs, 53 temporary construction jobs, and over $15 million of total economic impact in all as well. So as I look at all the current construction projects going on at the airport, and I see all those vests moving about and neon shirts and things of that nature, it's very rewarding to see the impact we're having, not only on the airport, but within this community as we continue to create the jobs. This is what it looks like conceptually. We've worked with them on this. You certainly, for those of you that have been out there, you see the progress on the state road and some of the turning lanes, and ultimately the contractor on that state road project will be shifting the traffic lanes to do the other side of the road. We would also be working with FDOT to create the turn lanes off of Spring Hill Road as well as off of Capitol Circle there. With that, we certainly would recommend option one. With that, next steps that we would complete, should you approve it here today, would continue the negotiations, continue on. Obviously, we have a few more steps to achieve as we move ahead, working with FAA and FDOT. This does fall on the outer limits of what we call our runway protection zone, so we got to protect the runway protection zone and the airspace, the final approach corridor coming into our runway 27, do the environmental assessment, the airspace analysis, finalize design, and begin construction. We would hope to move through that just as quickly and efficiently as we can, but there are some required steps with the FAA and FDOT as a part of that. So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions.
Excellent. Do we have any public comment on this item?
No, sir.
All right. Commissioner Williams-Cox.
Move staff recommendation.
Second.
Okay. It's been probably moved by Commissioner Williams-Cox, seconded by the Mayor Pro Tem. Any further comment? I think this is, congratulations, I support this as well. I think what's interesting to note is I love the creative revenue stream that this brings to the table. Goes into the formula of how much a price of a ticket to fly in and out of Tallahassee, and if we could do anything to help reduce that cost, I think it's a good thing. So, congratulations.
Thank you, Mayor.
Okay, Commissioner Williams-Cox.
Mr. Mayor, I see, although you don't think about the airport area being a food desert, but it is, because you have to go in the airport to get something. But if you have a resource outside where you don't have to go into the airport, but it still benefits the airport, you can go get you some milk and a drink or water and what have you.
Those were part of the discussion, certainly.
Absolutely, absolutely.
All right, any other further comment? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All
aye.
Opposed? Passes unanimously 5-0 with Commissioner Porter by phone. Thank you very much. We're on item number 12.02, Mr. Manager.
Thank you, sir. You'll recall in the end of 2022, you directed us to move forward with designing and building water and sewer services to what we were referring to as the Southside Triangle, an area that's south of the city's limits that does not have access to water and sewer. And we've worked to put that program together, and I'm very, very pleased to bring this item before you today that seeks your approval for a substantial amount of grants, nearing $12 million for this project. We knew the project would be expensive, but it was important. For not just the environment, but for the economics of there and for those residents and homeowners. And so we've got good progress to report, and you've talked about it a little bit today at your retreat. I'd like Andrew Platt to give us the summary and details of what these grants entail.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. Mayor and commissioners, have a quick update for you on the Southside Triangle Water and Sewer Project, and also to provide you with an update on a couple of grant opportunities that we've gotten some exciting news to share with you today on. As you're aware, the Southside Triangle Project's on the south side of town. It's bordered by Woodville, Crawfordville, and Capitol Circle there. Project is to extend water and sewer to previously unserved areas within the Southside Triangle area. Some key project benefits that this project will achieve is that it's consistent with the city's goals of protecting our natural resources and environment, specifically Wakulla Springs. It reduces the nitrogen within the Wakulla Springs spring shed. It eliminates potential costly repairs and replacements of septic systems by the extension of the sewer system into that region. It provides enhanced fire protection to area businesses and residents that are living there through the extension of water and the addition of fire hydrants in that region. There's also a benefit there that homeowners insurance premiums could be reduced as well with that. So all of that improves the quality of life for those citizens in that triangle area. It also furthers the commission's investment in the South Side Action Plan area. And the needed infrastructure does provide that catalyst for the potential for responsible growth and redevelopment in that region. So to kind of bring you up to speed on where we were to where we are, commission direction was provided to us on October 26, 2022 to provide that extension of services to unserved areas. Staff immediately went into a request for qualifications to select a design consultant to assist us with those design elements on the project. It's typical for a project similar as this. We have selected a design consultant, and that consultant has the design underway as we speak. The project is going to be a phased project. We've been very strategic about how we phase this. Phase one, for instance, is the utilities within phase one are in established rights of ways and easements. There's no requirement for any easements or right of ways on that. So we can move forward, we can progress that forward quickly. Concurrently with that, we're going to be designing phase two and three as we work through the design elements and easements along the way with that. The idea is to get those projects out and get them in faster. Our phase one design is set to be completed at this year. We're going to bid this year, and construction is anticipated to start early of 25. So now to the good part. Upon that commission direction, we received our staff investigated and searched for alternative funding opportunities to help leverage city funds on this project, and we identified two potential funding sources last year, 2023. One is the Springs Restoration Grant, and one is a Water Quality Improvements Grant. I'm happy to report I got really good news towards the end of last year that we received a $1.7 million grant from the Springs Restoration for the first phase of the Southside Triangle Project, and then we received an additional $10 million with the Water Quality Improvements Grant Program. So that equates to about $11.7 million worth of grant funds for this project. And I got to say major kudos to the team that put the grant applications together. They put together a solid grant application, and we were very successful with that. So what we are seeking today from you is authorization for the city manager to negotiate and execute a grant agreement with FDEP for those two grant agreements, two grants that we have there. Thank you very much for your time, and answer any questions if you have any.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it.
Do we have any public comment on this item?
No, sir.
All right, colleagues. Let me defer to Commissioner Williams-Cox first for comment.
Well, actually, I was going to go ahead and make the motion. Somebody want to give us some money. I don't want to hesitate.
That's right. Just comment.
Just a quick question. When the sewer is eventually installed, what will happen to the septic tanks? How are they?
The septic tanks, there's a process that's followed through the Department of Health. There is an abandonment of the septic tanks that we'll have to go through. It's a permitting process. Once that connection's made, then it will be abandoned.
Okay.
Is it a cost to the?
There is a cost associated with that, yes.
Okay. Mr. Manager.
But I'm sure it's well worth it.
Actually, Commissioner, it's a great question. I'm glad you brought that up because that is a piece. So we're building the water and sewer system. You know, it's at a great cost, but you're right. It doesn't connect to the home. Right. And these properties are in Leon County. We've worked closely with Leon County and a number of other neighborhoods to take grant funds to pay for that connection cost. Okay. And so that was a condition of us moving forward, right, that the county would use grant funds to pay for those costs so that the homeowner or the resident wouldn't have to bear it because it is substantial. Okay. And so we're building the system and then it'll have to be connected and grant dollars will be available to the property owners.
County septic.
Yeah.
All right. Thank Commissioner Williams-Cox for a motion.
Move for staff recommendation to accept the funds available through this grant opportunity.
Second.
Okay, it's been properly moved by Commissioner Williams-Cox, seconded by the Mayor Pro Tem. Any further comment? Commissioner Porter, any comment?
No, Mr. Mayor.
All right. All those in favor of the motion on the table signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Passes unanimously 5-0 with Commissioner Porter by phone. We're on item number 12.03. I will go ahead and tee this one up. This is the approval of the city attorney's appointment agreement. Ladies and gentlemen, you know that we, upon the previous city attorney announcing her retirement, we have been in the process of selecting the new individual that will be coming in to be the city attorney. We interviewed four recommended candidates after a healthy screening process done by the Human Resource Department, City of Tallahassee. Upon completing those interviews yesterday as a commission in the sunshine, we unanimously made the decision to offer the interim city attorney, Amy Toman, the permanent job. At that time, we also directed, and I'm going to ask Rob McGarrett to please come forward, correct me if I'm wrong on any of this and take it from here. The commission directed Rob McGarrett to formally reach out on behalf with our offer and to come to terms, knowing that as soon as we come to terms, then it would be brought back to the commission for ratification. Little did we know that we would be able to come to terms within 24 hours. Therefore, it allows us to put it on the agenda for tonight as modified and have this discussion publicly about formal ratification contract. Mr. McGarrett, I'll turn it over to you.
Well, Mayor, you've recapped what's happened in the last 24 hours quickly. Ms. Toman and I were able to get together and very quickly work through the standard template we use for appointed officials, made some very minor edits to it, and come to an agreement on a salary, and that's what's before y'all tonight. It's the standard type of agreement that we have for all of the appointed officials.
Excellent. Wonderful. First and foremost, colleagues, any questions to Mr. McGarrett about the contract before us? Okay. Thank you, Rob. Appreciate it. Mr. Clerk, any public comment on this item?
We do have one speaker on this item, Mayor.
Okay. Before we take public comment, let me ask Ms. Toman if you have any comment.
If I could just say again how humbled and honored I am to be able to serve in this position. And that I really appreciate the confidence, and I really look forward to working with my staff to continue to provide exemplary legal service for the city of Tallahassee.
Okay, let's get to public comment. Mr. Cook.
Thank you, Mayor. Our one speaker on this item is Stanley Sims, and if I may, I'll point out that the city attorney mentioned her staff. You notice that meeting attendance usually dwindles as the meeting goes along. We've seen a swelling of attendance as the entire city attorney's office is now seated in chambers.
There we go. All right.
And the prettiest one over there is my wife of 25 years. I'm Stanley Sims at 1320 Avondale Way. And Madam Attorney, I want to say thank you for taking on this job. I also want to say that, you know, I know that working with all of these people ain't easy, because I'm married to one of them. But it's so rewarding. And my wife is going to kill me for this, so I may need a lawyer after this. My wife is very conservative, totally different from me.
But when you were presented with this opportunity, she was elated. She was praying for you, wishing the best for you. And I also must say, she was not alone. The culture that has been established in the city attorney's office that I have witnessed for over 20 years is a family set. Has rescued me, not just my wife, but my family in good times as well as bad times. Even when a piece of peppermint got stuck to my dog buttocks, I thought it was a cyst. My wife had to rush home. We found out it was just a piece of peppermint. We all laughed. It takes a city attorney to not only to be able to interpret the spirit of the law, but the culture of the community. We are praying for you. I will not agree with you every day. You will probably be praying a lot of days with me. But the maturity and the professionalism would never, just because we disagree whether a traffic light may go on the right side or the left side, I know, Madam Attorney, if I was side the road with a flat tire, you would pull over and help me. That's good community service. That's a public servant. And I demand that. I like feeling that I'm special. And I believe living in America, it's a special privilege that we enjoy in our democracy. And I pray for you on your journey. Thank you for all you have done for me and my family. And thank you in advance for what you're going to do in the future.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Any other public comment?
No, sir.
All right. I am going to make the motion myself for approval of the option number one, which is authorize the city manager to execute the option number one to approve the proposed employment agreement with Ms. Toman and allows me to authorize on behalf of the commission and with your consent as well the agreement on behalf of the city commission. I will make that motion.
Second.
Is there any objections to a unanimous second, as our decision yesterday was unanimous as well? Unanimous second. Any other comments before voting? Commissioner Williams-Cox, and then Commissioner Matlow, and then I'll check in with you, Commissioner Porter, as well.
I just want to say congratulations, Amy. We look forward to having a robust working relationship. I'm sure that Ms. Jackson has shared how we work well together, and I look forward to us being able to do the same thing. I will consult with you to make sure that I don't do anything that causes us liability. I did that often. So I look forward to being able to do that. And so far, when I've reached out to you, you've been more than able to provide what is needed. I look forward to continuing that. And you know what our conversation has been. I'm counting on you. Thank you.
Commissioner Matlin.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I guess a welcome might not be appropriate because you've been here, but congratulations. I think it's a great fit for the city to continue to have much needed stability and professional oversight in the office. And just, I think, going through the interviews, you just rose to the top and did such an exceptional job, I think, on your answer. So congratulations.
Commissioner Porter.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Congratulations, Madam City Attorney, and I look forward to working with you.
Mr. Mayor Pro Tem.
Thank you. I just want to congratulate the interview was superb. Since we've had the opportunity to work with you, we know what your work ethic is like, knowledge and experience shown, if you
will in the interview, and so we just look forward to working with you in the years to come.
We are blessed to have an incredible city attorney's office. I'd like to ask all members to please stand to be recognized for their incredible work that they do. Attorneys, support staff, everyone. You know, to keep the 10th largest city by population in the state of Florida in the right direction legally takes an entire team. Y'all do an amazing job. Amy Toman, believe in you 100%. I look forward to working with you. It's going to be our brighter days are ahead of us. I have made the motion. It is unanimously seconded. All those in favor of the motion on the table signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those
opposed.
Passes unanimously with Commissioner Porter by phone. Mr. McGarrett, I will make myself available after this meeting or at your earliest convenience to execute the contract on behalf of the commission. Again, welcome. Turn it over to you for a couple of comments.
I really don't have anything else to say other than to, again, thank you for entrusting me with this honor. I really look forward to serving the city and, again, to working with that incredible staff that you just pointed out. To continue to do exemplary legal work. So thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Manager, do we have any other business come before us under policy formation and direction?
No, sir.
Okay, we're on unagended speakers. Mr. Clerk, do we have any unagended speakers?
Yes, sir, we do have unagended speakers.
Okay, let's begin.
The first is Dot Inman Johnson. Dot Inman Johnson will be followed by Paige Marshall Baldwin. So as with the other parts of our meeting, 3 minutes for each speaker.
Thank you for joining us. Your name and address for the record, please.
Good afternoon. Dot Inman Johnson, 2121 Trescott Drive. I also want to add my congratulations to Amy, but with a caveat, I was very disappointed to see City Attorney Cassandra Jackson leave the city. She was the one piece of diversity among our four appointed officials in city government, and a very talented and experienced city attorney. And I wish her well wherever she is. My main reason for coming forward, though, was when I was walking from my parking space, I encountered two young families with little children, and they were looking puzzled. And I asked if I could help, and they said, what is there to do? They were walking and looking for something to do downtown. Tallahassee is a beautiful city, has a very walkable downtown, but there isn't a lot to walk to. And I felt, I really didn't realize that until I saw that family. And I was trying to point them to something to go to. Cascades Park was quite a walk from where they were near the DoubleTree. And so I told them about IMAX and a few things downtown. So it brought to mind when I first moved to Tallahassee, downtown was a very active place to be. There were consignment and retail shops in downtown, lots of little wine bars where there was piano music in the evenings. And you could get your wine and cheese board, and lots of things to do, restaurants. And I'd like to see us return to that, but the main thing I want to suggest is that the city look to the county, the Tourism Development Council, and the Downtown Improvement Authority, and think about doing a tour bus for when new families come to town with the legislature or during the game season that can take them around to where the things of interest are, and they can go back later. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker, please.
Paige Marshall Baldwin, and then Samuel Doler. Paige Marshall Baldwin.
Let Irwin go first.
Is Irwin signed up?
He is signed up. Yes, sir.
George, Dr. Jackson. Your name and address for the record.
Irwin Jackson, 1341 Jackson Bluff. Mayor and commissioners, ex-Mayor John Marks is a liar and a cheat who has used the office of mayor for his own personal financial gain and to enrich his friends and business associates. This is a fact, and I will prove it to you. On December 13, 2023, this commission voted to glorify Marks' dishonesty and self-serving actions by naming a city building after him without comment. This commission needs to reconsider their vote, which cannot be defended and is an embarrassment to all residents who seek honest and ethical conduct from our elected officials. Marks' political career was based on a lie. It started with his lie. Marks filed to run for mayor in October 2, 2002 for the 2003 election, knowing all the while that he and his wife lived outside the city limits. How can a person not living in the city run for mayor? Marks and his campaign manager, the bagman, Sean Pittman, had a great idea. Their success only required that they lied to the supervisor election, they lied to the press, and that they lied to the citizens of Tallahassee. Marks cheated Tallahassee residents when he purchased an unfurnished condo in the city, had a phone installed that he could answer from his personal home outside the city limits. Marks claimed he lived in the condo and he didn't live with his wife in the big house outside the city limit. During the campaign, I and other residents would ask Marks about his residency lie. When radio stations would inquire about Marks, and his only response was nervously remain silent or lie. Marks won the election, became mayor of Tallahassee, but he didn't live in the city. Questions continued. This problem was not going away. Don't worry, Marks and Pittman had a solution. They would ask city commissioners to lie and support his residency lie. With the legal assistance of City Attorney Jim English, City Commissioners Debbie Lightsey, Mark Mustian, Andrew Gillum, and Alan Katz were asked to vote to annex in John Marks' personal house that was outside the city limits. This has never been done before or since. Commissioners, unfortunately, held their noses, looked the other way, and they did their best to cover up the Marks lie to the public. Now the condo's able to be sold, which is only a prop. Marks can focus now, and this is years ago, at focusing on how he could scam the public. Commissioners.
You're at 3 minutes.
Thank you. Thank Commissioners, I don't believe any of you,
thank you,
would vote to cover up Marx's lie. If you thank wouldn't you. Vote then, Dr. don't Jackson, honor his ask, lie please, now.
Please wrap
thank
up.
You very much.
Thank you, Dr. Jackson. Our next speaker, please.
Paige Marshall Baldwin, and then Samuel Doler.
Name and address for the record, please. You have 3 minutes.
Mr. Mayor, commissioners, my name is Paige Marshall Baldwin. I'm going to speak about John Marks. When John Marks ran for mayor, I was one of your local news talk radio folks. We, of course, interviewed every single candidate that came around, politicians and everything else. John Marks' interview was the beginning of what I consider disaster. It was a joke. I thought he was actually a prank candidate for a while. We had people calling in asking him, Mr. Marks, I am at your condo. There is no furniture in the condo. Where do you sleep? Mr. Marks, I'm looking at the voting record. Your wife lives in the county. Can she vote for you? It was absolutely ridiculous. At that point, I thought, compared to the other candidates we had on, he had no chance. Well, fast forward 3 days and a little bit of pressure on the station owner. I was fired based on that interview. I guess the corruption had to be protected. It all worked out okay for me. I went to war in Iraq. My unit was called up. It was actually a relief to have people announcing they were trying to kill me versus facing that kind of corruption here locally. I'm now retired out of the Army, and I come back, and John Marks is getting a building named after him. I guess he met the minimum standard versus Andrew Gillum. He's not in jail. And of course, no surprise that Gillum would vote for the corrupt act of getting his house into the city. Now, I speak in support of Irwin's ask that the building renaming be reconsidered. However, having covered this city commission and Tallahassee politics for a long time, not for the last 10, 15 years I've been gone, but just knowing some of the shenanigans, I really don't expect a positive result. I expect that everybody who voted unanimously to name that building goes home, looks himself in the mirror, and doesn't see anything wrong with it. If there is a change, I'll be delightfully surprised. My great wish is that you will consider not naming a building after this man and making it a monument to corruption. But if you do name the building and keep this plaque in place, I have a counter announcement, and that is that all of the toilets in the city shall be known as John's. Have a nice day.
Thank you. Our next speaker, please.
Next speaker is Samuel Doler, to be followed by Kelvin Frazier.
Your name and address for the record, please.
Is Samuel Doler, and is 32304.
You have 3 minutes.
I am very disturbed by the city's handling of public comment. There is a crackdown on free speech going on right now. About a block away, the House is discussing removing the financial aid of students who are in support of Palestine. That is the status quo of what we are going through right now. While this is going on, thousands of civilians are continuing to lose their lives inside of Gaza. And we've come now several months in a row asking you to stand with us. The first meeting we didn't get through. Second meeting, we got to the end, but all we were offered was thoughts and prayers. And in the coming meetings, we were talked over, cut off, corrected, and public comment became a back and forth with the mayor, where he would not address any of our issues as related to Palestine, but would fixate on decorum. This is very unprofessional behavior. The mayor would constantly randomly adjourn the meeting or call a recess in the middle of people talking. He discussed with the other commissioners limiting public comment to 30 minutes when we were clearly gathering more than 30 people at a meeting. There's no solutions being offered by this commission. All they're doing is trying to avoid us. And today they have rushed through this process as fast as possible to the point where there's only two of us who got here early enough to speak to you today. These tricks are dirty. These tricks are undemocratic. These tricks do not honor and respect our right to free speech while we are being attacked. I am tired of watching what is going on in the news in Palestine. I am tired of seeing so many people dying, so many people caught in the crossfires of what our money is doing. I'm a student. I should be worried about my procrastination when it comes to a test. But it seems this commission has something in common with me, because through the procrastination, more and more people's lives have died. So we ask you today, take a stand, both for our public comment, but also for the people in Palestine.
You're at 30 seconds.
Take a stand and affirm our rights, because right now, the disconnect between the City Commission and the people is disturbing. The firefighters even said it. I am honestly just shocked by how these meetings have been going, and it's, you want to tighten the ship, then you need to trust the sailors.
You're at 3 minutes.
Thank you. Our next public speaker, please.
Kelvin Frazier. After Kelvin Frazier will be Willie Williams.
Williams can go first.
You know I do.
Okay. Dr. Williams, you have the floor. Name and address for the record, please, and you have 3 minutes.
So. All right. Dr. Willie Williams, 4525 Westover Drive, Tallahassee, Florida. Good afternoon, Mr. Mayor, City Commissioners, City Leadership. I am delighted to be with you this afternoon just to share just a few things. First and foremost, to start this new year, I want to say Happy New Year and thank each and every one of you for your service. We know that you serve in positions that oftentimes carries a large weight, so thank you for the work that you do. And in saying that, I will say this, that the greatness of a community is not only measured by the leadership, it is also measured by the actions of its members. And so with that, myself as the chair of the Tallahassee Trainers Foundation, partnering with Black Men's Health with John Brown, the Council on the Status of Boys and Men with Royal King, and We Are All We Need with Kevin Warren, started hosting men's mental health check-ins for the past year. These have been going on quarterly on a Saturday morning in various locations. The purpose of this was to bring together men and young boys to see how do we start to address mental health issues that are taking place with these young men and try to see how do we start to chip away at this iceberg that was named in the Leon County Sheriff Homicide of Anatomy report. The format was simple, open dialogue. We did have a small panel that always consisted of one law enforcement officer to get that view, one person with an LCSW, and then various community members and a youth on the panel, and they just kind of led the discussion. Those four meetings end up hosting anywhere from 30 to 70 participants. Top zip codes were 32303, 05, and 04, respectively. It was 96% Black participants in that, all men. That's not to say it was limited to Black participants, because it's open to all men that want a safe and secure place to talk. And then 30% of those participants were 24 years or younger. So we were getting to the gist of the matter as far as the participants. Once again, that was open dialogue. We provided a safe and supportive place for them to discuss issues. Topics that came up from them was childhood trauma that the men were suffering from. Anxiety, stress, anger, bridging communication between the generations, manhood, fatherhood, and childhood. And so this is what we did to bring these young men together to try to see how do we start to bond, because we can't build stronger communities till we start to build stronger people. And with that, I yield the rest of my time. I just wanted to let you know some of the positive things that the members in the community are starting to do and need to start doing. Thank you.
Our next speaker, please.
Kelvin Frazier and then Stanley Sims.
Great. Your name and address for the record, please. You have 3 minutes.
Yes, sir. Kelvin Frazier, 1336 Castle Knoll Court. Good evening, Mayor, City Commissioners. I'm Kelvin Frazier. I'm the president of the Tallahassee Trainers Foundation. Here in the community, we are, So here in the city of Tallahassee, we have events, not only just for the adults, but also for the youth. Being able to educate the youth, not only on just fitness, but nutrition as well. We have certain events where it's also, let's say, the Cascade Park event. We had the Tom Brown Park event as well, just to cater to the youth. Also, let me go to the next one. Also, we have events for just the people in the community as well to help promote health and wellness. Not only that, we're here to also educate the people in the community as well about the movement that we're doing here in Tallahassee, right? So the goal is to always promote health and wellness in the community, to educate the people in the community by setting up programs and getting out to the community as well to educate them. Thank you so much. Right now, I'm a little nervous, but thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker, please.
Next speaker is Stanley Sims. And Stanley Sims will be followed by Harry Brown.
Mayor Stanley Sims, I'm still at 1320 Avondale Way. I want to publicly say that Mayor John Marks is my cousin, and Sean Pittman is my cousin as well. I appreciate the fact that when the mayor was here, Mayor John Marks, I could talk to him anytime on the street, in his office, at his house, in the city limits, outside the city limits. He was just that kind of man. I can't wait to show my grandchildren the building of this black man. Not only that, let me go ahead and claim Anita Favor since this bash black leader night. She's my auntie. Sent me a letter and a card when I was in prison. Don't many city managers do stuff like that, but that's the connection that she had with me, he had with me, Sean Pittman had with me. Even though we live in a land of democracy and we allow all Americans to come up and to share their opinion, and it may hurt me, but we can do that in America. Because if we were in Russia or in China, there would be different things. But Mayor, I'm here today because I want some clarity and I need to get on the record. I'm having difficulty communicating with staff. Even though that the HR director did the contract for the city manager in record time, I spoke to him today in reference about two pending issues where I'm having two city employees' aggressive behavior towards me. The HR director told me it would take him approximately 2 weeks to get to me. I view that's unacceptable. I'm not allowed to have any other communication with the inspector unless it's an email or a text message or something. Dana doesn't return any of my calls. I know that they're litigated, but someone should be able to give me some answers. I was told by the inspector that would be the city attorney's office. My wife works there, so I can't complain about them. But I'm asking for some help because I view that the HR director does not view the aggressive behavior from city employees coming against citizens as serious as our city manager view his interpretation of me acting like an insurrectionist. He does quick judgment, harsh judgment upon me fast.
About 20 seconds.
So I'm wishing that some direction can be given to the HR director so it can be set up some communication, because I'm going to respect all boundaries here. And I'm asking that you will respect my democracy and my freedom and my First Amendment rights. I'm so glad I have a paid attorney. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Our next speaker, please.
Harry Brown is next, followed by Jacqueline Perkins.
Your name and address for the record, please. You have 3 minutes.
I'm Harry Brown. I reside at 5431 Crump Road, Tallahassee. I'm here to tell the truth, nothing but the truth. So help me God. I wrote a book entitled One Man's Story Overcoming Evil with Good, Prayer, Humility, and Compassion. I gave my information to my publisher, and here's what he had to say in a brief synopsis. This book documents the historical practice of discrimination exercised against black and other minorities by the municipal government of the city of Tallahassee, Florida. Some city staff ignored a blatant and flagrant practice of denying minority employees the opportunity for raises, bonuses, and promotions, often withholding job vacancy lists while channeling minority applicants into applying for low-paying jobs. These discrimination practices began long before the Civil Rights Act of 1964. And in April 1975, a group of civil rights activists came together to file a lawsuit against the city commission and city managers, past and present, in the United States District Court of Northern District of Florida to document and stop these practices. The suit alleged that the city of Tallahassee engaged in practice of hiring administrators who would unethically do almost anything to carry out the racist and bigoted practices of the city administrators. Often when blacks were hired, they were not provided adequate staffing or equipment necessary to accomplish their job duties in a professional manner. And I documented how during the years of employment, wrongdoers intentionally brought many storms into my life. But I stated that faith brought me through and allowed me to witness the consequences of their wickedness when some were later arrested and convicted. I testified to the truth of scriptures. I lived by the help, overcame these trials, so that may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. For therefore we both labor and suffer reproach, because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially those who believe. Hebrews 13:6 and 1 Timothy 4:10.
Thank you, 3 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Brown.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker, please.
Jacqueline Perkins, followed by Tavish Bryan.
Your name and address for the record, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Jacqueline Perkins. My addresses are 3437 Blue Jay Drive and 1618 Key Street. It was here on December 13th, 2018, City Commission and CRA Board approved and funded the Bond Neighborhood First Plan. It was a monumental document developed and produced collaboratively by members of the Bond community, the City of Tallahassee, and other stakeholders. It is important to note that this effort was coordinated and led by Deputy City Manager, Ms. Cynthia Barber. It is also important to note that this document, the Neighborhood First Plan, was so innovative, creative, and impactful that the city won not one, not two, but three awards. Together, we made history, and the plan became the model for at least three other neighborhoods that are in the CRE district. I must underscore that this document included a component to preserve historic structures. It was approved and funded by the City Commission and the CRA Board. Well, we made history again. Members of the Bond community, including the oldest living resident, D.K. Richardson, Mother D.K. Richardson, submitted an application for a special categories grant to preserve the historic Robinson's Grocery Store. We wrote the grant and submitted the grant on behalf of the CRA with the permission and approval of the CRA and CRA board. We were blessed to receive an appropriation in the amount of $250,000 with a match from the CRA, which brought the total to $500,000 to rehab, restore, and repurpose the building. Our plans are to use this building for the benefit of the community, which is in full support of the project. There are plans to provide much-needed services to Southside residents, including copying, scanning, emailing, faxing, computer stations, kiosks to pay bills or secure services, tutoring, package delivery and pickup, meeting for small groups, et cetera, coffee and juice bar. And we also have a rest stop for law enforcement should they decide to use it. Unfortunately, we were not notified of the timeline for various and sundry reasons, and we are at risk of losing our funding. We are 8 months behind on the timeline. And without going through that, because I'm going to come back tomorrow to talk with you all in your capacity as CRA board members, but we are going to request that the CRA board, and I did get a chance to talk to Attorney Norvell, I don't know if he's here, but we are going to ask that you all make a formal request that we have an extension on the front end, because we have not met the deadlines. And even though we were told in one of the meetings that we were the grantees, we do understand that we wrote this grant on behalf of the CRA with the permission of the CRA director and the CRA board. So we're at risk of losing our money. We don't want to do that. We have, I think the last meeting we had almost 80 people there. A lot of people don't like to come out and speak, but we're hoping that the city and the CRA board can come into the community, and that if they can't come, I can provide videos, because there's nothing in the policy that says that people can't videotape their presentations. So I'll be back tomorrow to speak with you all regarding that, and thank you.
Thank you very much. Next speaker.
Next speaker is Tavish Bryan.
Your name and address for the record, please.
Name is Tavish Bryan. I will not be giving my address.
3 minutes.
Mayor Daley, you are a signatory of Mayors United Against Antisemitism. This official statement from the AJC brings up many legitimate concerns about antisemitism, from Holocaust denial to white nationalist Charlottesville demonstrations. However, this statement repeatedly calls upon its signatories to defend Israel. Alongside this, the AJC deems the BDS movement as essentially a hate group, referring to the movement as a human rights facade. In the face of all that has happened since October 7th, do you still stand with the AJC? The AJC refers to terms like apartheid and genocide as baseless in reference to Israel, despite an excess of evidence to the contrary. If these statements and your signature in support of them reflect your beliefs about Israel, I strongly invite you to defend these beliefs at the end of public comment. Tallahassee Community Action Center and other organizations demand an end to U.S. aid to Israel and its displacement and genocide of Palestinians. We demand an end to any partnerships and or relationships with Israel and Tallahassee, alongside any training, cooperation, or investments between the Tallahassee Police Department and Israeli policing entities and forces. I had the privilege to speak with some of you, including Mayor Daley, this morning at the retreat. We had a nice discussion about some bills, but I want us to be able to have a discussion about more than that, a long discussion, a discussion that includes what this commission believes about what is happening in Palestine, about its beliefs about Israel. And we cannot have that discussion if you don't allow it. We are here with a new decorum. We are here to present ourselves in a way that accommodates this commission. I want to know if the city commission calls for a ceasefire beyond Commissioner Porter. I want to know if this commission believes that what is happening in Palestine is a genocide. I want to know how this commission defends statements from the AJC, like referring to terms like apartheid and genocide as baseless. How can you defend that? We need to have this discussion. We need to be able to speak about this. So I encourage you all, please open that up for us. Allow this to happen. Otherwise, we will get nowhere. End U.S. aid to Israel. Free Palestine. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Our next speaker, please.
Next speaker is Angeline Lachey. Mayor, that's the last speaker card I have at this time.
Your name and address for the record, please. You have 3 minutes.
Angelina Lachey, 3025 South Adams Street, Tallahassee, Florida. I came here a couple years ago, and I told people about certain concerns I had with my apartment complex. I'm specifically speaking to Mrs. Cox and Mr. Richardson, because oftentimes when I hear people voice their concerns about Southside, both of you are very vocal to say, well, Southside is good. We got this. Southside gonna be all right.
Could you pull your microphone down just a little bit? That way the audience can hear you better. You should be able to just grab it and pull it down.
Yeah, I don't want to knock my phone down, so I'm just like this. So, and I reclaim my time. So there's people in our community right now, and this is my first time bringing it to your attention, so maybe you aren't aware, but there's an energy that's manifesting from people who are just not happy because of the housing that's taking place, who are unaware about what's going on with the CVS that was torn down. A lot of the people have to walk now longer distance to get to places where they once could just walk across the street. A lot of the children are going to the corner stores where they once could just go to CVS. So specifically, I'm asking, how do I, as an individual, find out what's going to be put in the place of the old CVS and what's going to be put, and this is Adams Street across from the fairgrounds, and what's going to be put next to the Planet Fitness in between the cigar lounge? Those are some concerns that the people in the community want to know. As I said, the energy is manifesting because the people don't know what's going on, and a lot of times the people don't know how to be involved in the community because many of them don't even know about city commissioners' meetings, and they're just unhappy. And what happens is, from the top to the bottom, if people are unhappy, they get restless, right? And crime starts to go up. I hear the alarms often in my community, and I'm saying from the top to the bottom because if the adults aren't happy, then they're sending the energy down to the children. And I want you guys to just be aware of what's happening. Going back to the beginning, I came here and I told you guys about my concerns about the apartment complexes. The management there, they can be very mean to the people in the community. And people don't know who's in charge. So the question is, who's in charge of Tallahassee?
You're at about 25 or 30 seconds.
Because if the people, we the people, are voicing our concerns, as I said, this is my first concern. So at the next meeting, I guess I can tell you that I found out who's in charge. But if the people supposed to have the power and the people say, hey, these are my concerns, then the people should be the ones in charge, which means we get to decide who's running these properties in our community. We get to decide who's putting up stores in our community. We get to decide about everything. Did I get my extra time when he cut me off?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Y'all have a good day.
Finish your thought.
Then I need more time. You just cut me off again. All right. Thank you guys for listening.
Thank you. Our next speaker, please.
No other speakers tonight, Mayor.
All right. Sharing of ideas. Commissioner Porter, start with you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Sure.
I'm really not feeling well, so I'm going to, I don't have anything tonight. Thank you.
Okay. We hope you feel better. Commissioner Mallow.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. A few comments on public speakers. Ms. Perkins, I've heard your comments. I believe that's a CRA discussion that we can have tomorrow morning. I wanted to correct a little bit of the record. One, it was said that former Mayor Andrew Gillum is in jail, and I'm a firm believer in the laws of our country. And while he did face charges, he was found not guilty and had other charges dismissed. Secondly, on public comment and public participation, I think this commission did have a conversation about welcoming public comment, and we've had difficult meetings, but I think unanimously we decided we want to work with people, we want to hear from people, and I think that should be commended. Because whether we disagree on issues or not, I know the mayor specifically has always been a champion of, you know, let people speak. When you first came onto the commission, there was a 30-minute limit, and you laid the groundwork to not only speak before an item, after the item. Like, we've always pushed for more public feedback, and I'm thankful for this commission for respecting that. On the issues raised, it's very difficult to have conversations, one, that aren't specifically about city business and what we can affect, because there's so many issues that we could discuss and take strong positions on. What I do feel strongly about is what our role is as elected officials. You know, when we face, and I respect everybody's right to protest. If you want to say everything you dislike about what I'm doing for 2 hours, I think that is your right as a member of the public. But if we're going to have conversations about how we can work together and what we can achieve and what we could believe, it does start with a conversation. I think what we saw, you know, we were criticized for 2 hours before we hadn't taken any action, we hadn't had any public position at all. So we started from a point of no dialogue at all. So if we had started from a point of how do we make sure both Palestinians and Jewish members of our community in Tallahassee feel safe and respected in our community, I think that's a good starting point. I think I'm anti-war across the board, whether it's Iraq war, what's happening in the Middle East now, I'm for a ceasefire always. I don't think we should be using military might the way we do. And I'd criticize our own country when we enter agreements as well. So I do appreciate the speakers that have come today and being a little more willing to have an open conversation. But I would just say, don't always assume the worst. You know, we don't always need to start from a place of criticism, because it makes it very difficult for us to have open and hard and honest conversations. Whether we can ever get to a place where the city commission can have any impact on foreign policy, I don't know. I don't necessarily think we can. But you know, all that to say, we do appreciate public feedback, but also while we may agree on certain issues or certain and disagree on certain other statements that are being made, I do think the public is welcome. You are a part of our city, and we want to have those conversations. And I think our offices are always open also to have conversations outside of chambers to really dig down into details. Because, I mean, to me, I think at the end of the day, as we talk about with gun violence in our community, ending loss of life is paramount to the beliefs of all of us. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Commissioner Williams-Cox.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I wanted to revisit something that I began today at the at our retreat, to solicit my colleagues' support of a symposium that's coming to Tallahassee February 26th through 27th, teaching our own history. I was approached by a local leader and organization that the city and the county to partner to bring this symposium to fruition here in Tallahassee, and welcome in guests and speakers who will be coming into the city to support this symposium. The symposium is teaching our own history. As we know, this is our bicentennial year, so there's a lot of history being discussed. This history in particular deals with issues that we've dealt with, the African-American history and other history. All history is important, because African-American history is American history, just as in any other history. And so I'm asking my colleagues to support the being co-host or a partner with the county to bring this symposium to the city of Tallahassee. Again, the date is February 26th through 27th. As you know, that is the end of Black History Month, and so very fitting that we would want to make sure that during that month we're teaching our own history. And it would include daily seminars and participation with congressional panel. There will be individuals coming from Congress, other elected officials, the Black press, faith leaders, students, and millennials. And also Reverend Dr. Freddie B. Haynes III, who is the national president of the Operation PUSH, as you may recall, that Reverend Jesse Jackson for many, many years led this organization, and he has since retired due to age and health. And this gentleman has been selected to carry that on. More information can be provided, but I'm asking for your support that we would partner with the county to bring this symposium to the city of Tallahassee.
Is that a motion?
That is a motion.
Second.
Comment. Commissioner Porter, comment. Commissioner Mallow, Mayor Pro Tem. All those.
On the motion.
On the motion. Great. All those in favor of the motion on the table signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Aye.
Passes unanimously 5-0 with Commissioner Porter on the phone. Commissioner Williams-Cox, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. That will be it.
Great. Mayor Pro Tem.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. Just one comment for the young lady that was asking about development of the what used to be the Winn-Dixie Shopping Plaza where CVS was previously located. I have talked to a couple of business people in the community who are in the process of looking at developing that property. I put them in touch with with OEV staff, Office of Economic Vitality staff, and I know they, I don't know exactly where they are in the process, but I've met with them and they're looking at doing some commercial development in that complex. That's all I have.
Great. Well, first of all, what a great day. We've had a fantastic retreat earlier this morning, the annual retreat, and what a great meeting. I appreciate everybody from the public that participated today, joining with us to help with the decorum and make sure that we have an opportunity to have everybody speak. And I just thought it was a great meeting. We were able to get a lot of the a lot of great views to the table. Look, it was brought up. You need to understand that whether it's as dad and how I teach my boys or as mayor, whenever I have the opportunity, whether formally or not, to stand against anti-Semitism, Islamophobia, racist statements or actions, or any other perceived hate speech, I'm going to stand up and make sure that this community is a community that stands for love, togetherness, kindness, and try to do everything that we possibly can. I think we all agree with this, too. We want Tallahassee to be a safe city for everyone. Commissioner Matlow, I thought your comments were extremely eloquent, and I appreciate what you had to say to put on the table, and I think we all agree. So, yes, I am proud to stand up against racist actions and words and deeds. I am proud to stand up against any language or deeds that try to suppress any group, whether it's religious-based, whether it's how we look, who we love, whatever it may be, and I will continue to do so. I want to welcome everybody back to 2024. This is the bicentennial. It is going to be a great year. And with that, we stand adjourned.